All right, so I'll talk about privacy, learning, and inference. My name's Adam Smith. I teach at BU in the computer science department there, and I'm very happy to be here. Okay, so the context for the talk is, I think, not news to anybody, which is that sort of what we mean by privacy and the importance of privacy is has been changing very quickly over the past few decades. You know, data-driven systems guide decisions in all sorts of areas of our lives, you know, from predictive policing to medical diagnoses and everything in between. And the models and sort of statistical reasoning that drives these systems is increasingly complex. And so we're faced with trying to understand, how, on one hand, how we can get the benefits of all these, all the data we're now collecting and these increasingly complex prediction models and, you know, inference models that we know how to build. And sort of making sure we get those benefits, but balancing them against concerns about the kind of side effects these systems have on our lives, and these revolve around questions of privacy, but also, you know, things like transparency and control and accountability and fairness and all sorts of sort of concepts that go with automating large systems and important decisions. So what I'll be talking about is sort of one aspect of that big problem, which is statistical data privacy. And it's helpful to imagine the problem faced by an agency like the U.S. Census. So they collect information from lots of individuals. They have a mandate to make that information as available as possible to researchers and to other government agencies and to businesses in a form that's as useful as possible and that ranges for through everything from very simple statistical summary, very simple summary statistics, through various kinds of complex models and statistical models, and even sort of synthetic data, stuff that looks and feels like real raw data, but somehow fulfills their other mandate, which is to protect the privacy and confidentiality of the information they collect. Okay, so they're faced with this tension between trying to make the data as useful as possible and as available as possible, and yet, guaranteeing confidentiality to their respondents. And there's really nothing special about the census here. You can think of any agency, be it a company or a nonprofit or a government, that collects individual information and wants to make it available in some form, but it has concerns about privacy. Okay. And this comes up, of course, with census data, but also, you know, large collections of personal information are ubiquitous everywhere else too. You know, public health data, social networks, education, you name it. There's a problem. Okay, so we're interested in understanding the trade-off between these two basic conflicting goals. On one hand, utility, getting as much out of the data as we can, and on the other hand, some kind of notion of privacy. And what I'd like to claim is that we understand what it means for the data to be useful much better than we understand privacy. That is, arguably utility is the thing that any field that deals with data thinks about, from day one. And so, of course, what we mean by useful is going to be context dependent, but by and large, it's well understood. And the question drive the first two-thirds of the talk is, what do we mean by privacy? Okay, so it's not a new question. It's been studied as far back as the 60s in various fields. But what I'll try to explain today is progress that's been made in computer science over the last 15 years or so of putting this field on much more rigorous foundations. Okay, so, of course, you might ask if it's just too late for privacy. We hear various accounts of how privacy is dead in the new op-eds and popular science and stuff like that. I wouldn't be giving this talk if I agreed. We're generating new data and new sensitive data and private data of increasing complexity all the time. And also, privacy is tied to lots of very basic questions of, you know, freedom of speech, freedom of association. We're seeing how the connection between the acquisition of private information and the sort of the way platforms manage and shuffle and direct content has sort of changed the way we think about the flow of political information, especially. And so I really think it remains a very important question. You know, it suffices to imagine a society without much privacy, just for a second to sort of, you know, convey the importance. And this is a cartoon by Rob Cunningham, and I like the caption on it. All right. Okay. So this talk, what I'd like to explain, I'll start with trying to explain why privacy is challenging, the privacy in the context I'll be talking about, why anonymization is problematic, and I'll talk a little bit about some of the kinds of problems that come up, the way statistical models and learning models leak information. I'll talk about differential privacy, which Dove mentioned. And then I will I'll end with sort of some reports from the frontier, sort of a few topics that are topics of current research that are like very active right now that I think are interesting. And that I'll see, you know, how much time I'll have to get through those depends on how we go. And of course, you're welcome to ask questions during the talk. Okay, so why is privacy challenging? Let's imagine we've got some data set we want to make available for general use. The first thing we could consider doing is just removing obvious identifiers, right? So we could imagine stripping away names and exact addresses and telephone numbers and social security numbers and stuff like that that we know how to use to look people up and just publish what's left. Okay, and that has several problems. One is that it could be that the thing we're interested in is exactly related to those identifiers. Like maybe we need exact addresses for an epidemiological study or something like that. But more problematically, it just doesn't work. Okay, so here's a photograph. I've helpfully grayed out the face of the person in the photograph, but most of us can recognize the man at the podium there behind the lectern there pretty quickly, maybe with a tinge of nostalgia. And and the point is that, you know, even though the face is missing, there are all these other clues, other cues in that photograph that we use to figure out who's there, right? Now, it's a toy example because, of course, you know, Barack Obama is a celebrity, but in some sense, with the right database, we are all like celebrities of that stature, right? And the point is that there's all this other information that we link to, like we can connect to other things we know about the world, right? And the richer our data is about the rest of the world, the more people we can identify in these ways, okay? It's not actually even entirely a toy example. So people looked at face blurring software and showed that, for example, if you train a face recognition model on blurred images, you can often use it to recognize blurred faces. You know, people have done, you know, studies of sort of identifying information just from a genomic information which has been stripped other identifiers like names or demographic information or whatever. You can often reconstruct that information. And like one of the surprising examples is for a lot of men, you can predict their last name. Men in the US, you can predict their last names with some reasonable confidence from just their genomic information. And that's because most in the US or Western societies, most men inherit their Y chromosome and their last name from the same person. There's lots of other examples. One I like is a taxi data set from New York City that was, again, anonymized and released, and it was possible to re-identify people and the rides they took and where they were going and find out all sorts of things about people from it. Okay, so the lesson I want to draw from these from these examples is that in some sense, the reason removing obvious identifiers doesn't work is because, in some sense, everything's an identifier. There's sort of no real dichotomy between identifying and non-identifying information. Okay. Now, you might assume that really the problem is granularity. That if If we were only to release sufficiently aggregate information, we'd be fine. Okay. And that's true at some level, but the problem is that this notion of what it means for information to be aggregate is remarkably thorny to pin down. Okay, and I'm going to try to explain two issues with it. One is that complex things we train from data, even though they look aggregate, often reveal individual information kind of directly. So a nice example are what are called support vector machines. So this is an algorithm for training a certain type of classifier. It trains a hyperplane classifier for what the inputs are points in real space. And one describes the output of the algorithm exactly via a set of data points that define the solution, the hyperplane. Okay, so what are called support vectors. And so basically the output of the algorithm is a subset of the data. Even though you sort of think of it as being a hyperplane, that's not actually the way it comes out. And a lot of the deep learning models that we're using increasingly these days and that are increasingly popular, reveal even more information. So I don't know if it might be a little small on the slide. So this is a screenshot from Google Translate, translating from Somali to English, okay? And to reassure you, agagagagag is nonsense even in Somali. And then what came out is like a phrase from the Bible. Okay, and now you put in a different Somali phrase, and you get out a different English phrase from the Bible. Okay, so what's going on here? Does anybody have a guess why? Phrases from why this like the model is like speaking in tongues. So it turns out that like if you think about what the canonical corpus is for translation, there's like one thing that's been translated consistently across many, many languages, and that's like the King James Version of the Bible. And so what happens is these models, when you're looking at languages for which there's not that much data on which to train the translation system, they tend to overfit to those relatively small corpus they have, and so you can get those models to actually spit back to you exact chunks of their training data. Okay, so the models actually leak information about their training data, and just if you think of like where this might be an issue, imagine like Smart Compose in Gmail, where it's like it offers to complete a sentence for you, right? So what people have shown is that this is you can sort of even these models, if you train them on data that have sort of relatively unique phrases in them, you can get them to spit back out like social security numbers and things of that form, okay? Unless you're very careful about how you train them. But the point is that it's hard to know what's going on because these models are sort of opaque to they're complex enough that it's hard to have an intuition for what's going on, okay? And this observation has come up in a bunch of different ways and in different types of discussions, be it about generalization and actual like accuracy or about other things, that these modern models tend to memorize their inputs in one way or another, and so they end up leaking information in various unexpected ways. Okay, now you might ask if this is necessary. So, is it the case that models must leak information? And the answer is no, not always. But actually we're starting to get an understanding of when that is true, and finding settings where we can argue that if you want a model that has like that is as accurate as possible, you need to pay some cost in terms of like basically that model will encode individual examples more or less in the clear. So Vitaly Feldman has this paper that came out this year, giving natural problems where any learning algorithm that is sufficiently accurate has to memorize the labels of basically all of its training data. Okay, that is, in order to be to match the accuracy of the best possible algorithm that would be using the same sample size, it has to actually it has to remember the explicitly remember the labels of all the almost all the training examples. And you know, one work in progress that I have with, also with Vitaly Feldman and a student, Gavin Brown, we're looking at sort of natural problems where every learning algorithm actually has to memorize like all the bits of relatively complex examples. And so you could actually, you can sort of, from the algorithm, if it's accurate, you will be able to extract extract a lot of the inputs just by using black box access to the model. Okay. So this is one type of problem. Another type of problem is that when you're releasing lots and lots of statistics, many statistics taken together can encode data and encode sort of the input data in surprising ways. A really trivial example is if I, let's say I took the, you know, calculated the average salary of the people in this room immediately before and after someone walks out of the room. Right, so either of these averages on their own doesn't tell me much information, but if I take those two averages together, I can combine them to learn exactly what that person's salary was. Right, but so that's sort of a really easy example. But more generally, there's a realization that too many, in a very general sense, if you have too many too accurate statistics, then you end up revealing individual level information about data points. Okay, and there are a couple of lines of work in the literature kind of that show that in different ways. And one are called reconstruction attacks, another called membership inference attacks that I'll say more about in a slide or two. these were kicked off by this seminal paper of Irit Dinur and Kobi Nisim. Kobi, who's nearby here at Georgetown, where they kind of introduced this idea and showed that it comes up in lots of surprising ways. But the sort of meta message of this body of literature is that you cannot release everything everyone would ever want to know about your data without basically revealing the data itself. And so there is a trade-off there, and we're forced to somehow navigate it and figure it out and understand it. Okay. So just looking at the time, I was going to talk about membership attacks that came up. I'll tell you a little bit. All right, so this paper by a bunch of biologists in 2008 looked at the kind of data that are released based on what are called genome-wide association studies, or a certain type of clinical study. And what they show, these are very high-dimensional data. And what Niels Homer and colleagues showed is that if you have exact versions, if you have exact high-dimensional summaries of a certain type, then they allow an attacker who not necessarily to reconstruct the data. It turns out this is a setting where reconstructing the data would not be possible. But surprisingly, to figure out things about specific individuals from these summaries. And like one example of that is just figuring out if a person is in the data set or not, which for a clinical study, and also sort of which part of the data set they're in. So it would allow you to distinguish, say, people who are in the study and have a particular condition from the people who are controls in a study. And in a 2015 paper with my colleagues, Cynthia Dwork, Thomas Steinke, John Allman, and Salil Vadan, we looked at trying to sort of understand theoretically what was going on there and understand to what extent these types of problems are robust to distortion that was introduced in the statistics. And we gave a sort of noise tolerant, like a robust version of these membership tests. And subsequently, and now it's now a topic that's being investigated a lot in the security and machine learning literature under the name of membership inference using machine learning models. And that was kicked off by this paper of Chakri et al. A couple of years later. And I have a couple of slides on these membership attacks, but I think I'll skip over them because just in the interest of time, sorry. So I apologize for the flashing the animations past you. Okay, so the things I'd like to kind of leave you with from this section of the talk is one is that there, you know, in some sense everything's an identifier. It's not productive to try to distinguish identifying from non-identifying features, especially that that distinction often relies on some like modeling of what sort of other data sets are currently available today, and that in, that type of modeling goes out of date really fast. Also, if you once you start releasing lots of accurate statistics, they allow you to either reconstruct individual data points or learn about individual people. And maybe more generally, that this sort of notion of aggregate information is hard to pin down. And what I'd like to do next is sort of give you one formalization of that idea that actually has teeth to it. Okay, so that's going to be differential privacy, and this is based on, this part of the talk is really based on, you know, many years of work, but it was kicked off by this paper from 2006 that that Dove mentioned earlier. Okay, so differential privacy, it's is what it is a restriction on an algorithm that's publishing or sending out some kind of information about a data set that allows us to make concrete statements about what sorts of attacks are possible on the individuals in the data set. There are several current deployments of systems that are differentially private. Apple and Google have systems for collecting information about how people use their, in particular, mobile devices, and in Google's case, their browser, Chrome. The US Census Bureau is working on, will have the public use data products from the 2020 decennial census will be differentially private, will be produced by a differentially private algorithm. And they're looking at how they can use similar levels of rigor for protecting the other types of things they produce from their other surveys. And it's also a burgeoning field of research that, as Dove mentioned, has sort of grown far beyond crypto and data security into areas like algorithms and statistics and learning. There are nice connections to game theory, nice connections to systems questions about systems design and verification, and also increasingly interesting connections with law and policy, where differential privacy is being used as sort of a natural language version of differential privacy, a kind of a softer version of differential privacy is used as a standard for various types of decisions. Okay, so I'm trying to explain a little bit about what this notion means. Imagine we've got an algorithm that takes a data set of individuals, so each person contributes one record, and we'll call them X1 through XN, and this data set consists of records of some kind, and we're not going to specify what the type of those records is. They could be anything. They could be numbers, or like bits, but they could be something complicated like text forms, right, or images. We'll think of the data for now as sort of fixed, so some kind of worst case over data notion. But there will be randomness in this picture, and that randomness comes from this procedure, this algorithm A that's processing the data. We'll assume that's probabilistic. And so for every data set X, the output of A is actually a random variable. So it's got its own probability distribution. And this randomness could come from adding noise. It could come from various kinds of, maybe subsampling or other more sophisticated procedures. And our definition is going to be based on a thought experiment, where what we'll do is we'll consider changing one person's data, maybe to add or remove them from the data set, or just change their, replace their record with garbage or something like that. And so, and we'll ask whether or not the probabilities of, how this probability distribution of our outputs will change. Okay, so we'll compare two worlds, the blue world and the green world. And in the blue world, is the real data, and the green world is this sort of hypothetical world where one person's data have been changed. And we'll look at, the blue world gives some probability distribution. We'll look at the probability distribution in the green world. And we'll ask that for any set of outcomes that I might want to consider, the probability is assigned in these, that the probability of this outcome happening in these two worlds, those two probabilities are about the same. Okay, so for example, if I consider the set of outcomes where some result gets published, and as a consequently, I get denied health insurance because of some new model that the insurance company built. That outcome will be about the same, will happen with about the same likelihood, whether or not my data were used by the data, in the data set. Okay, so more formally, we'll say that two data sets, X and X prime, are neighbors if they differ in one person's data. And our requirement is that neighboring data sets, neighboring databases, induce close distributions on outputs. And this is parameterized by this number, epsilon. So we'll say the algorithm A is epsilon differentially private if for all neighboring data sets, all pairs of data sets that differ in one person's data, and for all kind of sets of possible outcomes, the probability that I see one of those outcomes in the real world, and the probability that I see that same outcome, that one of those same outcomes in the green world, those are very close to each other as measured by this parameter epsilon. So epsilon, you should think of it as a sort of a small but not very small number, like maybe 0.1 or 0.5. So you should think of this as this quantity here, the epsilon, think of it as like roughly 1 plus epsilon. And what epsilon controls how similar these probability distributions are. So the smaller epsilon is, the more similar the distributions are, the less the dependency on any one individual's data. And here we can think of this epsilon quantity as some kind of measure of leakage or measure of dependency. Okay. So this is going to be there are variations on this definition. This is the simplest, and that you can change little things about it, but they all have the same essential flavor. So let's look at some examples of things that actually satisfy this, just so we have something concrete to talk about. One of the examples that satisfies it is very old. It's called randomized response. It's a survey, essentially came up as a survey technique in the 1960s. So there, imagine you've got some survey you want to run that is sensitive enough that people are going to be uncomfortable giving you exact answers to the question. Okay, so suppose I want to know how many people in this room have cheated on an exam. Okay. So each person has a data point, which is locked in their head. It's either a 0 or 1, or more accurately, I guess we're measuring it. Do you admit to yourself that you ever cheated on an exam or something like that? But so each person has a bit, which is either 0 or 1. And now what we're going to do is ask each person, a simple version of this, is I give each person a fair die to roll where I can't see it. And they roll the die. If it comes up 1, 2, 3, or 4, they answer honestly. If it comes up 5 or 6, they answer the opposite of their true input. Okay? And now, so it looks like this. Everybody takes, we've got up here, everybody has their value. Everybody rolls a die to get their outcome. So each person generates this random thing, yi, which is either their true answer or not their true answer. With probably 2/3, it's their true answer. And then the sort of the output of the algorithm is this list of perturbed bits. Okay, so that's the outcome of our answer. That's how the algorithm works. This is simple, maybe the simplest example of something that satisfies our definition. So this is in the green box in the top right. I just have the same algorithms summarized. And you might ask, why is this private? Well, let's conduct a thought experiment. Let's change my bit from 0, which of course it is, to 1, And now we see that if we look at sort of the probability of any outcome of any particular list of outcomes or set of lists of outcomes, the probability that I say 1, now it happens with probably 2/3 instead of 1/3. And what it means is the probability that for any set of outcomes, the probability of that set goes up by at most 2. Okay, so that one way of thinking about this is sort of gives me some sort of plausible deniability, right? Even if I'm answering honestly, if my answer is 1 and I answer honestly, the person seeing the output isn't sure if I'm answering that because my bit is really one or because I just happened to roll a five or a six. Okay. And it satisfies this definition with epsilon equals about 0.7. Okay. And you can modify this to satisfy the definition with a much smaller value of epsilon. It's just harder to describe. Why is this useful, by the way? This is sort of a side point. It turns out, you know, given this vector of y's, it's actually not that hard to get a pretty good estimate for the fraction of 1's in the input. Not by taking the fraction of 1's in the output, because that's off, but if you rescale it appropriately, you get a decent estimator for the number of 1's in the input. An example that's one type of example. Another example that actually works for the same problem but works better. Suppose I've got uses noise addition, and it's been come to be called the Laplace mechanism for reasons you'll see in a second. Suppose we've got some summary of our data set we want to release, such as the proportion of cheaters in the room. Okay, and suppose that we've actually collected the true raw data in one place. Okay, so one natural approach is to compute the statistic we want to release and add noise to that. And if we do that, the natural question then is, well, how much noise do we need to add to satisfy this definition? Okay, so it turns out the idea is that you can get an upper bound on how much noise you need by looking at some measure of variability of the function, of sensitivity of the function to individual inputs. And one clean measure is called the global sensitivity. So this is how much can the function value change if I change one person's data. So for example, if we're looking at the proportion of cheaters, if I change one person's bit, the proportion of cheaters in the room goes up or down by at most 1 over n. And you can extend this notion to like more complicated vectors of outputs by sort of looking at the norm, some norm of the change viewed as a vector. Okay, so this is some measure of how much this function f spreads or collapses inputs as a map from sort of inputs to outputs. Okay, and so the theorem is that if we add noise from the right distribution with standard deviation at least or about this global sensitivity divided by epsilon, then we can satisfy our definition. Okay. So the amount of noise now goes up the more sensitive the function is, the more that the function value can jump around as a function of one person's data. And it goes up as the stronger, the higher level of protection we want, the less leakage we want to see. Specifically, the distribution from which we add noise is called Laplace distribution to satisfy this specific definition. And it has this kind of pointy Gaussian shape. And the reason it sort of satisfies our definition is that if we change one value in the data set, what we're effectively doing is comparing two versions of this same distribution that have been shifted relative to one another. And then we can just argue that this distribution, this particular probability distribution, when you translate it, you don't change the probability of any event by a large multiplicative factor. That's true. And you can prove similar things for like Gaussian noise and stuff like that, but it requires a more complicated variation of the definition. This is the simplest one.
Are there some assumptions on the function that you made?
They're encoded via this sensitivity quantity. That's the restriction on the function, effectively, is that you're using a property of the function. So if the function is just something crazy, then what the theorem will say, well, is like add so much noise so that the output is totally useless, right? So you can either say it's an assumption on the function or not, but the theorem is true either way. It just may not give you something useful. But for proportions, just for calibration purposes, you know, we'd be adding noise on the order of 1 over epsilon n. Okay. If I think of, let's say what I'm really interested in is not how many of you cheated on an exam, but how, you know, what I view you as some representative sample of, you know, academics, and now I want to know, I want to think of, you know, estimate the fraction of academics who've cheated on exams. And there, I expect to get, just due to the fact that, you know, it's a random sample and not everyone, I expect to get a certain amount of sampling error, and that's normally on the order of about 1 over square root of n, which goes to zero. So 1 over epsilon n for modest values of epsilon goes to zero much faster than 1 over square root of n, if that, you know, that helps. Okay, and turns out, if I want it, like an example of how this comes up is that if we want to release d proportions, like a higher dimensional thing, lots of proportions, then we can do that with noise that scales up with roughly the square root of this number of proportions, the number of things, statistics we're trying to release. This is one example of something you can do. And I'll just mention that that requires a slightly different variant on the definition, but I'm not going to explain the difference. But maybe one interesting thing is that notice the amount of noise we're adding goes up with the dimensionality of the problem. And it turns out that's inherent. Like, we just can't do better than that. And that's because of some of these attacks that I mentioned, these membership inference attacks that I mentioned on the earlier slides. It turns out that there are attacks that kick in. They start working exactly when the amount of noise that's being added to the statistics is less than this amount. Okay, up to some wiggle room of 1 over epsilon, which I've helpfully made very small on the slide. Okay, but basically what we understand at this point is that at least for certain relatively clean settings, we understand that there are pretty sharp thresholds where, you know, below which you get certain types of attacks that start working, above which you can prove reasonably strong statements like differential privacy. Okay, so this is now a field. So I give you a couple of very simple examples, but people have looked at much more interesting ones. You know, noise addition and lots of variations on that are studied. There's something called exponential sampling, which is a sort of more general way to create algorithms that satisfy this criterion that gets used a lot. And then there's a sort of another kind of third category of important algorithms are based on local perturbation that are kind of like that randomized response example I gave you earlier. And they have the nice feature that they have this structure where the randomization is done data point by data point. And so one nice feature of that is that in principle it could be done on users' devices without ever collecting the raw data in one place. So this class of algorithms gets a lot of attention for that reason. So let's see. I just wanted to mention there's a lot of literature on this. I'm not going to try to survey it at all. But what I do want to spend another minute on is sort of why this. I want to claim that if I claim this definition is sort of a meaningful one, I should give you some sense of why I think that is. Okay. I want to make some very general claim about what's possible or not possible to do based on the outputs of this type of algorithm. The kind of claim I'd love to make is that if you are an attacker and I am a person in the data set, then you learn nothing about me from the output of the algorithm. Okay, that whatever you believed about me to begin with, before seeing the output of the algorithm, after seeing the output of the algorithm, your beliefs about me would be about the same. Okay, that would be a nice statement. That's certainly the kind of thing we can say about like encryption, encrypted data. Okay, but it turns out this is impossible here. and it's impossible for a reason that I can explain just with an example, although it's been formalized in various ways. Suppose you know ahead of time that I smoke, because you saw me outside smoking a cigarette before the talk. Now you read some clinical study that says that smoking and cancer are closely correlated, right? Suppose you didn't, let's imagine it's the 1960s and this was not like common knowledge. From this clinical study, you have definitely learned something about me. Okay, you have learned that I am at a high risk for lung cancer. You have learned that I'm a bad insurance risk. You know, lots of things. You've learned lots of things about me. Okay. But the point is that you learn, and this is like actionable information about me, right? You could raise my insurance premiums or deny me insurance or whatever it is. But the point is you've learned this thing about me, not because my data were used in this study, but because the study is telling you something about, like, the world, right? And so what differential privacy gives you is that it limits the kinds of things you can learn about me to those types of things. So it says no matter what you know ahead of time, you learn almost the same things about me, up to this epsilon quantity, whether or not my data were used in the study. Okay, and that allows us to, prove, for example, that algorithms that satisfy this notion, in particular, resist the kinds of attacks I mentioned in the first part of the talk. Okay, so. At this point, there's lots of work, as I said, on differential privacy, on algorithmic ideas, various kinds of theoretical results seeking to lay out basic just feasibility and like understanding the kind of computational complexity and sample complexity and other basic measures of performance of differentially private algorithms. Also, looking at variations on the definition. There's lots of work on design tools and work on, you know, programming and query languages that make it easy to write programs that satisfy this restriction, logics for proving statements about those programs, and evaluation platforms for comparing them. There's tons and tons of work on like specific algorithms that are tailored to a particular type of data release or a particular application. And fascinatingly to me, there are lots of connections coming up to other areas. So one of them are these connections to law and policy that I'll have one slide about a little later. Some of them are, there's some interesting connections to what's called adaptive data analysis and how, to what extent it is statistically sound when data sets are reused across several studies. And some really interesting connections to game theory, which I won't get into. Okay, and it's these, you know, there's lots of papers on that. I don't know, I have some random statistics here, but there are lots of papers on this. Okay. Okay, so what I wanted to spend the last few minutes on are sort of what I'll call, you know, reports from the frontier. So just a random, more or less random sampling of topics correlated to the things I happen to be interested in right now, of research going on in this area of the things that I think are cool. So one area that's very active right now is to what extent can we train interesting machine learning models on data subject to this constraint of differential privacy? And specifically, you know, can we train the kinds of complex learning models that we are increasingly used in practice? And the answer is sometimes no. As I mentioned earlier in the talk, we know there are cases, we now have sort of theorems that are showing there are relatively natural problem instances where there's no learning model, deep or shallow or whatever, that doesn't basically memorize the data, a big chunk of the data, and make it easy to extract. But on the other hand, there are also positive statements, and certainly I've worked on this a fair bit over the last few years. So both looking at sort of algorithmic techniques that could be useful. So like one thing that I and many others investigated at this point is looking at sort of noisy versions of various classic optimization algorithms like stochastic gradient descent or other similar first and second order algorithms, and how they could be used to train models while satisfying differential privacy. And also, fundamental theory of understanding how large, for various statistical problems, how large of a data set do we need. So like one example of a more basic theoretical question is looking at just classic statistical problems and understanding how the number of samples I need, the size of the sample I need to answer them changes subject when I add this constraint. So with Clément Canon, Gautam Kamat, Audra McMillan, and John Ullman, we have a paper this year looking at the structure of what are called quote, simple hypothesis tests, which they don't actually have to be that simple, but what that means is that you're trying to distinguish two basic settings. You've either got, you know, one distribution, call it P, and a bunch of samples from that distribution, or your samples all come from some other distribution, call it Q. And you just want to know whether or not you're dealing with samples from P or samples from Q. And what we have is a result characterizing how many samples you need to solve this problem differentially privately. And along the way, an interesting thing is that we had to come up with a new characterization of the sample complexity, of the basic statistical question, absent any privacy constraint, the classical non-private question. So that this classical answer to this question is called the Neyman-Pearson test. It's which is a fancy name for you choose the distribution which is more likely to have generated the data you're seeing. what we show is that the first thing we show is that the sample complexity of the problem remains the same even if that test is itself noisy. If instead of choosing the distribution that is more likely, always choosing the distribution that is more likely to have generated the data, you do what's called like a softmax version of that test, where if the kind of two distributions are more or less equally likely to have generated the data, you flip a coin, and as one becomes more, if as the sort of ratio of those two probabilities of generating the data, as that ratio increases, you are more and more certain to produce the correct answer. And so we show that sort of noisy version is as good as the original. And then this allows us to give a differentially private version, which is not always as good as the original because there are real reasons it can't be. But we are able to characterize it in terms of sort of various features of the probability distribution. Another area that's very hot right now is deep learning with differential privacy. And this was kicked off by this paper of Martina Badi and others at Google a few years ago. So there, what they're looking at is training deep learning models using differential privacy. And the basic idea of the algorithms that are currently the state of the art is to run some noisy version of the training algorithms we would have been running anyway. And also, and this is sort of less obvious from the papers, simplifying the models so that there are fewer parameters. So the extra constraints of differential privacy push you to use models with fewer parameters, and then the way you train those is the way more or less very similar to the way we train models not non-privately, but adding noise, and that allows you can prove statements about this sort of end-to-end iterative process. And it has this sort of interesting kind of shift, right? When you train deep learning models, often they're revealing various parts of the training data, and so you know it's good that we're now finding ways that these can be hidden. It also gives us a lot more confidence about how we can use these models. So right now, a lot of the models people train on sensitive data, those models are not made publicly available because of privacy concerns, because they can encode sensitive data. And so often the companies are not very transparent about how these models work and how they're trained, and that has its own transparency problems. And so the promise of training these things differentially privately is that potentially you can get to the point where you're totally confident releasing a complete description of the model because you're sure that it doesn't encode individual level information. Sorry. You can, if you want to play with the software, the Google has a package that's part of TensorFlow that allows you to play with this software. Another sort of area that's very active right now is connecting legal and sort of more policy-based notions of privacy to technical ones. Okay, and there are really two central types of challenges. One is, you know, given a body of law and regulation, you want to understand what technical definitions comply with that law. Okay, so sort of this is a process of understanding, you know, what is it that the regulations are actually saying, and to what extent do these, and they're all always written in like natural language, you know, usually English or French or German. And understanding to how they correspond to various technical notions, and in the other direction, asking how we should formulate these notions so that they're a little more future-proof and correspond to an actual sort of modern understanding of the technology. And so these are, you know, my favorite example of this is that, you know, our surveillance laws are still called wiretap laws, which conjures up images of like, you know, guys in fedoras and suits sort of putting, you know, actual crocodile clips on wires. But, you know, that's not the way surveillance is done at this point. And technical research really has to inform these questions. You know, just a simple example is that I think one of the sort of positive things that's come out of all this work on breaking anonymization is that, you know, this notion of personally identifiable information has been sort of exposed as not especially meaningful. And there's really some nice work going on how we can really connect mathematical formulations to these sort of more natural language notions. And there's actually, I'm involved in some work with my colleagues at BU that's in process, and a nice example of this is work by Kobi Nisim, who I mentioned earlier, who's at Georgetown nearby. Okay, so the third frontier of research that's ongoing is on this interesting connection between privacy and overfitting, okay, and what's called adaptive data analysis. So currently, in you know these days, data sets are not, they live long lives, right? They're collected, but then they're, especially scientific data, they're collected and they're used across many, many studies. And the questions that are asked in later studies often are chosen based on the answers or, you know, outcomes of the earlier studies. Okay, and this is especially prevalent, for example, in the social sciences where it's really expensive to collect good data. And so you get this situation where the sort of larger process of data analysis is adaptive in the following sense, that you run some analysis, you get an outcome, that informs the choice of a second analysis, you get some other outcome, and so on and so forth. And the problem is that this way of doing things fundamentally breaks the statistical model that is generally used to analyze, to think about data analysis, which is normally you think about the analysis procedure is chosen and then the data are collected. Okay, and they're independent, you don't think of them as somehow being tied to each other. Right? And it turns out that in this adaptive setting, that's no longer true. You can overfit a lot more quickly than you should, and you can sort of think you've discovered things that are not actually features of the distribution, but the things, features of the population you're trying to study, but just features of the sample you happen to have obtained. And the normal tools we have for controlling that kind of thing, you know, p-values and cross-validation, and you know, similar tools, they don't work in this adaptive setting because they assume independence of the analysis from the data. Okay, so it turns out that differentially private algorithms actually help prevent overfitting in these types of settings. And essentially what they do is they weaken the dependency between the outcomes and individual data points in a way that you can still get things that are meaningful, but because there's less of a dependence on individual data points, you can prove statements about how biased subsequent analyses will be that are based on those outcomes. Okay. And I don't have time to go through. I had a couple more slides on this, but just I'll skip ahead. So this was driven, I think, a lot by this a paper that came out in 2015 by Dwork, Feldman, Hart, Potassi, Reingold, and Roth, And this is something I've worked on quite a bit in the last couple of years, where we're looking at, you know, we found tighter connections between privacy and similar notions of stability, algorithmic stability, and overfitting. And these yield the best known bounds on statistical accuracy that we have for these adaptive settings. And also kind of a general information theoretic framework for thinking about these things, where we can show that, you know, to the extent differential private, we can interpret what's going on in terms of various measures of information between the outcomes of the analysis and the input data. Okay. And I'm happy to talk about that offline. I'm sort of out of time, so I'll skip over the slides that actually have more detail. And I'll just wrap up. So as I said at the beginning of the talk, you know, data are increasingly used to automate decisions, all sorts of decisions. And I think this really calls for, and I think people are responding to that at this point, a very different perspective on what security can mean for these types of systems. Right? So traditionally, computer security has been about controlling intrusion, roughly speaking. But you know, there's some clear boundary between people who are in the system and people who are out, what is supposed to be revealed, what's not. But I think our modern perspective has to include broader notions of trustworthiness of these systems, and that can include that can mean questions of privacy, but it can also mean things like resistance to manipulation, questions of fairness and accountability, and other other similar notions. So we need a sort of much broader notion of what it means to think about the security of a system. But I think that the traditional tools of computer security are still useful. The kind of adversarial mindset that security researchers bring to these questions is still useful. And I think we're seeing, and we will continue to see, much tighter connections and more integration between like security and crypto and machine learning as these systems spread through to more and more parts of our lives. So differential privacy formalizes one little piece of that big question, or provides one formalization of one little piece of that. But the question I'll leave you with is just what other areas need this kind of scrutiny? And I hope you'll add to that list. All right. Thanks very much.